Okay, so first off, I would like to explain why this video even exists. It took me 11 months to make this stupid thing start to finish. We spent a bunch of effort to put this together. This silly, double meme, whatever thing had us try a bunch of new stuff out. We do things a little differently from other artists. Most people have an idea, they sketch it out, polish it, line it, color, shade, light, do some rendering if they really want to, and bam, finished product. All in the space of a month, a week. Heck, some people even do it in a single day. It's nuts. Me? Well, yeah. There was gonna be a whole paragraph here about how little attention this piece got, but after some reflection, that's not really all that true. Though that sentiment is part of what brought me to make this video. I originally had this silly section making fun of how much of an attention whore I can be sometimes, which, yeah. But also, I want to make a little ditty about how I made it, because it's fun. Now, this is not a tutorial, it's just me info dumping about a thing I did. Stuff like this would normally go on my Patreon, but since this was going to be special, I thought about making it into a Tumblr post like I normally do. But there's a couple things about that. Because I take so goddamn long to make anything, people don't really seem to be attuned to the fact that I even make stuff at all. So they see something like this, and they just think I'm being a weirdo. Which I am, but The other thing is that people don't like super long text posts. They really don't like super long text posts. I don't like really super long text posts. It's just a wall. People don't read. I sure as hell don't read. You think people are still into books? Huh, Neil Gaiman? No! I'm a writer, but I don't write books. I write scripts. Gone are the days of Mr. Roger. We are in the Cocomelon age, baby! So, I need a way to show you the whole process in a super easy to digest way, make it super engaging, and be able to put it out there really fast. So, I'm gonna make a YouTube video in a single fucking
quarter.
Name's Abby, by the way. How's it going? Like I said, I'm a writer. I tell stories. So, why am I doing this? Why did I spend almost a whole year for this? Well, project management was supposed to be my first writing project to be published ever. A story showing people the value of productivity practices and project management while addressing its relationship with mental health. However, after a bunch of personal hardship and really rough times for me IRL, the projects changed with me. Those times really made me into a different person. One who is not the right person to make the project that I had once envisioned. So, it went through a whole rebranding, changing the theme to tell a far more personal, emotional story, now codenamed Project Snowhill. I won't go into detail here, but something that happened to it during that time was a new production workflow. Modeled after what is done in the filmmaking industry, it detailed what I had to get done and in what order so that I had all the stuff necessary to move to the next bit, and the next, and the next. So we did the initial concept writing, drafted up a list of locations to flesh out, and did a little bit of figuring out what were the characters that we needed to tell this story. So, you got a list of stuff that you're gonna have to do. You have to ask yourself, do you even know how to do that? Can you even do it? And how long would that even take? Do you need more gear, more money, other people? For me, the answer to that last one had to be no. And so, we did up a list of things we need to learn before we can even consider making another attempt at a comic. Things to learn so that we can at least get a little closer to what I've got in mind. And we got a pretty nice list here, I'd say. Let's focus on the ones that are the most pressing. My backgrounds suck. Like, a lot. If I was gonna make a comic, I'd have to draw a lot better backgrounds. And a lot of them. Like, a lot, a lot. Maybe not one for every panel, but still, like, a lot. And having to sit there, drawing the same furniture, walls, floors, ceilings, buildings, ornaments, and other dumb stuff over and over and over and over sounds fucking boring. But what if I did something less boring? Like 3D modeling. What with the meshes and the lighting and geometry and textures and stuff. Not only that, but you could rip a page off the old TV production book and use the same sets for the entire multiple season run of the show. I could use the same environment to make all of the scenes that take place there, just by doing a bunch of different renders. Project Snowhill calls for about 2 nude scenes. Not even exposed bits, just clothesless. So we had to test out 2 things. Was I even going to be okay with there being nude depictions of me out there for the sake of the project? Can we even depict my body in a way that looks right? On the bright side, this was shaping out to be a simple drawing. You don't even have to think about clothes. How long could it take, right? 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 Abby, hi, will be the main character of Project Snowhill. Shocker, I know. And we're gonna have to draw her a bunch of times. Again, real surprising. So we're gonna have to get her, me, down pat. We have to make sure that Abby looks like the same person from panel to panel, from chapter to chapter, across the whole story. Makes sense, right? So... we want to practice drawing Abby so that we can get her appearance consistent. But because of the weird angle, we struggle to get her pose and perspective right. Just like with the cake piece. And you know why? I am not good at drawing. I am good at constructing images and using software. So after our first go, we tried again. That sucked too. It seemed like we're just not cut out for this. I mean, how are we gonna get consistency with her while knowing how we're supposed to draw her from different angles? I mean, we could make a ref sheet, right? Nope. We're gonna make a 3D reference model, because of course we are. And would you look at that? Clip Studio Paint has a tool for you to put in and customize a 3D reference model and save them for each of your characters. Isn't that neat and convenient, and in no way will cause us any problems down the road by using different 3D stuff in the same image? This was pretty straightforward since Clip Studio has pre-made models already rigged that can have their proportions adjusted with some sliders. We did, however, make 2 different versions since the first one wasn't quite right. So after fiddling with it for a bit too long, we had the final sketch ready for lining. And after lining was color. Then shading. How are we going to figure out the light source? How do we know if we're even gonna be able to use Blender? Is the Blender file a different project from the illustration itself? How is this supposed to go? How are we even gonna...
Blender is a complicated piece of kit, alright? No doubt about it. Lots of moving parts and little modules. The thing up to learning about any piece of software is knowing what parts to learn first and what modules do you really need to finish your project. Tutorials are a godsend in this modern age.
Yeah, having a proper guide to hold your hands with the basics is pretty good. But you still have to put the work and effort to it. We actually had to go through the whole beginner tutorial twice so we could get the process down.
Welcome to Cats and Gray Sweaters R&D. Ops is just the actual drawing bit, but here at R&D, we explore new tools, techniques, and skills to apply to our work. In the past, that meant brushing up on anatomy and figure drawing, or doing a bunch of studies of landscapes and stuff. But now, it's all about that software, baby. We used the donut tutorial by Blender Guru to get the basics down and did a little practice with a sugar cookie. But since we were doing this alongside the actual piece, not to mention that I had a full-time job at the time, it went by pretty slowly from December of 22 all the way to April of 23. Alright, we made a cookie. Now let's make a chair. Oh.
To be something tighter. Let's go side view mode. Yeah, right where that line is right there, that's where I want to do it. So I just double tapped G just to slide that along. And then I'll add another loop cut here, Control R, click once to start the operation. And then again, it's just going to slide it up until it's about there. Double tap G again. And there we go.
So that was going to take a bit more time and effort. Okay, maybe more than a bit. But, we're going to have vacation from work next week. For my anniversary with the BF. I'm not gonna bore you with that one. You can go watch the tutorial for yourself if you want. Now that that's done, let's make a room. And how do we do that? Alright, so we have a carpet, a chair, a light, and another light just for good measure. Now, the camera. You see it, don't you? If you don't see it, I'm sure you can feel it. That cold drench of dread slowly washing down your face, the faint headache setting in, a sickness to your stomach, a defeated sense of helplessness, the daunting future, a future of your own creation. Oh, there's a problem, all right. But it's not just any problem. This is an oh shit problem. How are we supposed to make this line up with this? Or this with this? And the field of view? An object in space is one thing, but the focal length of two cameras that are virtual, whose software don't even speak the same language? How? Okay. So, we went and made a couple of test models, one of which seemed more useful, so we looked for a way to export it to CSP, and we did. Shortly after that, we stumbled upon this YouTube short and found a tool that can extract the camera specs for a Blender render out of a photo or image. So we downloaded the tool, tried to use it, looked up a tutorial, actually used it, and then exported the camera settings and put everything back on the grid. And that is why we put the chair in the corner of the room. I hate shading. 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 Okay, for real though. I took so long to shade that I did it long enough to actually get better at it, so I could go back and redo the parts that looked like absolute shit. I think I'm better at it now, but I really hate shading. So I'm almost done with the shading on Abby. The shading on the background pretty much does itself in Blender. But there's something off. And I can't quite... Oh. Oh. Oh, shit. Abby is not casting a shadow. There's no way for her model to cast a shadow. Because the thing she's supposed to cast a shadow on is in a different fucking piece of software. So we could try to pull a do-it-in-post and try to somehow brush over a multiply layer or something. But it would probably look like shit anyway. And then, how would we even know where to put the shadows? So, the way I saw it, there would be two options. Find a way to get the Abby model out of Clip Studio Paint and into Blender. This would mean that we wouldn't have to model anything, and the shadows would be super accurate. As long as we could get the pose just right. Which, if we can't export the pose as well, will be a pain in the ass to get right. The other option was to create dummy meshes in Blender and have them cast the shadows. We wouldn't have to model it super detailed, and we wouldn't even have to model all of her, just the bits that would actually cast a visible shadow. But what if we missed a body part? What if we got something in the wrong spot, or the wrong shape? We wanted it to be as accurate as possible. So we looked into exporting from Clip Studio Paint, and... What if... What the crap? The base model is one file, and the modifications are a separate file that are applied to the first one. The modifications are saved in a different format, and the pose is part of the .clip illustration file. Anyway. La 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 la. So yeah, the ideal thing would have been to download a generic character model for Blender, edit it, save it, and use it to map out a pose after doing a super quick mock-up and clip. Now we know. La 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 la. There. Cool. 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 So, lighting is a bit of a nuanced thing. From illustration to level design to 3D, ask any photographer or cinematographer or heck, even a video editor, and they'll tell you that lighting and how you place it and color it, as well as how bright you make it, is a fucking science as much as it is an art. So, until now, I've kind of eyeballed it, just to get an idea of where the light and shadows were gonna be. But for the finished piece, it looks a bit too warm. So instead of actually looking stuff up, I took a screenshot of my daytime setting for the light in my room on my Philips Hue app, a call I took from the Google Home app, took an eyedropper tool to the screeny, converted it to hex value, and put it into Blender. Huh. It looks a bit cold. So I took that color, along with the previous color, and put it on a canvas, made a few more colors, both warm and cool tones, converted the good ones to hex, and put each of them in Blender and pitted them against each other, only to find that the one I eyedropped from the screenshot off my phone was the best one. Go figure. So, you see this? This is flat colors with the shading done. Looks kinda weird, huh? Looks off. You know what it looks like? You know how you export a TF2 map in Hammer without any lights and it'll just render in game as full bright? Yeah. Like that. Simply put, it looks like Abby is being lit by a different color light that is way brighter than the one lighting the chair and the walls and the floor. So, we put a plain white plane, almost like a blank sheet of purely white, non-reflective, super coarse paper. See that? This perfectly white paper doesn't look white. So, we take our daylight hex value from before, put it back in HSL, put it as one of the layer colors for this multiply layer, and mess around with the sliders until a perfectly white layer under this multiply looks close enough to the white sheet on the Blender thing. Have your 2D white line up with your 3D white. And, do the shadow too while you're at it. Slap your signature on that shit and you're ready to go. All in all, this was a success. Part of the whole point was not only to see if we could do it and how it would look, but also how to do it. What to do and what not to do. You know, stuff to make it easier and better and faster in the future. We did a lot of figuring stuff out. And yeah, it was worth it. We took a while because we were putting different stuff together, experimenting for ourselves. This number right here represents the core stuff that was done on the piece. And this is all of the figuring out stuff. So, yeah, that's why it took a while. Thanks for watching this random crap. I really do appreciate it. Check out my socials if you want to see my art. I'd say my Fur Affinity is the best to browse all of my main art pieces in, but I also have my art-only accounts as well as my personal social media accounts on the doobly-doo. I want to take a quick moment to say that I've been going through some pretty bad mental health stuff lately, made way worse by some pretty bad financial stuff. So, if you'd like to help me out with bills, food, or even just a pack of cigs, that'd be pretty awesome. Patreon and Ko-fi are down below. Thanks again for sticking around. Have a good one.